Welcome into the SunDevilSource.com postgame show. My name is Zane Hopin, joined by Chris Cartman and Kevin Stewart. We're here on the field after the Sun Devils' 37-31 victory over the New Mexico State Aggies. The Sun Devils came out hot. Manny Wilkins looked like the experienced quarterback who deserved the starting job coming out of the offseason. Started out for 6-for-6, took a 14-0 lead, but eventually the Aggies crawled back 14-13 at halftime for the Sun Devils. Another hot third quarter for Manny Wilkins, 10-for-10, eventually led the Sun Devils up 37-13, but the defense gave up 18 unanswered, including a touchdown at the last second of the game. Chris, what were your first impressions of this?
Well, first of all, the defense played the entire first three quarters. They didn't sub on nickel. They didn't sub on any defensive line rotations. Only when Caron Crump cramped up or got hurt and came out of the game did they substitute. Then Tayshaun Smallwood had to come off the game because his helmet came off that one point in time. Other than that, they didn't really substitute until the very end of the game. I think those guys were gassed. 101 degrees at kickoff. It really speaks to the lack of depth that ASU has in its secondary. A couple of those guys weren't able to play tonight due to probably a suspension is what we're hearing. Chase Lucas, Maurice Chandler, Manny Wilkins, the ebb and the flow. This was almost like a microcosm of Manny Wilkins in one game of football where he starts out really effectively, then they go through a lull. Maybe part of that was play calling. Has a great third quarter, throws one of the best passes probably he's had in his career, 60-yard touchdown to John Humphrey. Some positives, ASU is going to have a dramatic improvement from week one to week two and then building subsequently for it to be able to have the type of season that it hopes and that fans hope.
Kevin, obviously an up and down game for ASU, and like we had talked before this, a hot first and third quarter, but a not so hot second and fourth.
Yeah, they weren't really able to sustain much in the second and the fourth quarter offensively. I thought Wilkins overall played well. I think he was 22 of 27, 300 yards. He didn't have any interceptions. But the running game was, Balaj had a couple big plays, but really kind of non-existent. They couldn't get anything consistent going in the running game. I think most of Balaj's yards came in three or four carries. So they really struggled to run the ball. The offensive line didn't protect Wilkins all that well. They didn't have a lot of time to throw. I agree with Chris about the defense, too. They, seemed like they're gassed. Todd Graham said after the game they didn't use nickel at all. So they were basically playing 11 guys all night on defense.
And piggybacking off that, we saw a lot of nickel from the Sun Devils last year. And, like we keep saying over and over, only 11 guys playing through the first three quarters. And Todd Graham had said this really was their plan going into the game in the press conference. And it's really all what Phil Bennett did. What do you think of his first game as a Sun Devil?
I was kind of surprised by the lack of nickel, and maybe not completely because we didn't see a lot of in practices in recent weeks, so maybe that was a hint that they weren't going to do it. They're limited with their defensive backs. Jamarcus Rhodes is a guy who's played corner safety. He's out there kind of in that kind of a role. But just the toll. They had 49 defensive snaps, I believe, in the first half alone, 85 plus by the end of the game, maybe 90-ish snaps. Todd Graham said at the press conference, that's too many snaps. That's going to be a problem, especially when you're playing in this kind of weather. Now, they didn't have that many guys go off for cramps, but the other thing is DJ Calhoun and Christian Sam were running all over the place in all kinds of shifts and having to cover all this ground laterally. You're just not going to be able to do that over the long season when you're so shallow. So they need to get more guys out there who are able to compete. They did play the three freshmen at the very end of the game, burning their red shirts, Alex Perry, Ty Thomas, Langston Frederick, right? So that tells you that they know they're going to have to count on those guys as the season wears on, and they're going to have to get development out of them. There were moments where they were good. They had the interceptions came in zone coverages where those guys were sitting back and being reading what was in front of them and making some plays. But there were a number of missed tackles. Joey Bryant got targeted and had some flaws. And there was, just kind of average play against the run, I would say, throughout the game. And that was a talented rushing attack led by Rose. But still, it's New Mexico State, and ASU will face a lot tougher than that throughout almost its entire schedule.
And like we keep saying, I think everyone was expecting to see much more substitutions out of the defense, especially in the secondary. Kevin, what did you think of the secondary's performance tonight?
I thought they held up rather well. They didn't give up a lot of big plays, but then again, New Mexico State did run 88 plays, so they weren't getting off the field. I think they struggled to get rush with four when they only sent four most of the night. They didn't send them most of the night, but when they sent four, they weren't getting pressure. So I think that was part of it. But they didn't seem to be giving up the big plays. They had that one late where they surrendered a big play. But overall, I think they were a little more sturdy, but they were still giving up stuff underneath.
And obviously the other coordinator, Billy Napier, making his Sun Devil debut. You know, we talked about the bomb to John Humphrey from Manny Wilkins, and we saw a lot of different looks in the running game. What did you think of the way Napier coached up his guys?
Well, they had a lot of combinations of their personnel with the running backs and tight ends. J.J. Wilson, Kalen Ballage, Demario Richard till he gets hurt. Nick Ralston starts the game out there. I don't know that anybody necessarily anticipated that. Played a big role. Tommy Hudson wasn't used as much as I maybe thought he would be. I was only out there for maybe one play until late. But what I did think that was a good sign for ASU was Kalen Ballage's usage early on in the game. I think everybody knows that he needs to get the ball as many times as possible and in ways in which he can be successful. And they showed that's possible in this offense tonight. It didn't exactly get executed to the way they would have probably liked, but it's out there for them. And they threw the ball to J.J. Wilson on that one play that was like a wheel from the slot. That was nice. That hinted at potential there. I think Eno Benjamin, I maybe thought he would do a little bit more than they did. They went away from some of the things that were working, which sometimes that's the nature of offensive coordinators, is you get a little bit redundant or you feel like maybe we need to mix it up or it's too repetitive. But the things that you're working, like Todd Graham said in the press conference after the game, if you're working, you might as well just keep doing it and take what they're giving you. ASU had the underneath open the whole game, basically swings, the ability to throw screens into the flat. They were getting 4, 5, 6 yards. Even when they only were winning 14 to 13, they were averaging 6.1 yards per play, which isn't that bad. And they were manageable down in distances in a lot of the game, but they just, you know, sort of weren't able to keep doing what was working. I think they just tried to do a little bit too much.
And this team all camp emphasized how they want to get back to physical running, especially in the offensive line. Kevin, what do you think of the way the offensive line played, especially in the run game?
They really struggled to get anything consistent going. Like I said earlier, there was a couple of chunk plays, but they couldn't get those 4 or 5 yard plays consistently, and heard a lot of talk in the offseason about they want to be a power run team, set up the play action. They really had no chance of doing any play action tonight. You didn't see much of it. And moving forward, you know, the schedule's only going to get harder. If they can't establish that against a New Mexico State, they're going to have problems when they start playing the Pac-12 schedule. The run game's got to get better, the pass protection's got to get better, but they just got to get a little more consistent, be able to get that 4 and 5 yards on first down.
Obviously, the talk all offseason about Manny Wilkins and Blake Barnett coming in from Alabama, product somewhat of Billy Napier. We saw snaps from both of them. What did you take from both their games? Obviously, different sample sizes.
Well, just the way in which Barnett came into the game, it wasn't really a situation that was conducive for him being successful. I think it was maybe his second snap. He had the zone read play where if he gives it up, the running back gets killed, and if he keeps it, he gets killed because of some of the protections. And it wasn't just the offensive line. Tight ends missed blocks all over the place today. Nick Ralston had a couple. J.J. Wilson had a couple. That contributes. You know, the total package is not just how your five offensive linemen block, but the guys around them didn't really do all that much. So almost an incomplete grade for Blake Barnett. He had that one throw that seemed a little bit awkward, but maybe his bell was rung after the play immediately before that. Manny Wilkins was just okay. We know what his limitations are at this point. He's going to have bouts of inaccuracy in stretches. He's going to overthrow some guys. He did some of that today. He's going to miss a secondary or maybe a third option. He's going to be a half-field reader. But he did okay. I mean, he was relatively accurate overall, especially at getting the ball to places in the perimeter where they can get some yards. It was a lot of run replacements as opposed to running the ball successfully in between the tackles. And maybe part of that is because of the way that New Mexico played in the box. I would give Manny Wilkins maybe like a C+ or a B- grade for an opener. You have to take into account the fact that this opponent is, you know, probably about as bad as ASU is going to play defensively all season. But it was decent, and it was something that they could probably build off of.
And one of the topics whenever you discuss Manny Wilkins is going to be his decision to run and taking hits and when to slide. We saw him slide a few times tonight, but overall, I guess, what's your take on Wilkins' performance?
I thought he dialed it back a little bit. You didn't see him leave his feet, which is something that obviously was a problem last year. He seemed like he had to run a little more than he probably even wanted to tonight. I don't think he was looking to run as much as we saw last year. But overall, I thought he played pretty well. I'd probably give him a B. So when he doesn't make any turnovers, it's hard to get for me to grade him much lower than that.
And obviously, Todd Graham emphasized the 100% ball security in his post-game press conference. What can you expect from this secondary in terms of takeaways going forward?
Well, what I noticed today that was a lot different from ASU in the past defensively was those takeaways all came in zone situations. Kobe Williams sitting back, playing off coverage, reading the defense. It's escaping me right now. Who had the other interception?
Joey Bryant,
same situation. He's playing like 8 yards off, eyes in the backfield the whole time. And that's something that I anticipated would happen because we saw in camp linebackers dropping into zones and getting picks of Blake Barnett and Manny Wilkins, including the one that was returned for a touchdown at the Camp Tonizona practice by Abraham Thompson. So we'll probably see more of that. Yeah, I think there's the ability to confuse offenses about what coverage shell that they're in any given situation because they have enough variety of what they're doing. The flip side to that would be Kobe Williams having a hard time against size, right? And he's going up against a 6'6 receiver who really manhandled him in a lot of ways in the end zone and other 50-50 ball situations or what should have been 50-50 ball situations. And some of those were difficult catches to be sure, but it's not like it's going to get easier as Kobe Williams goes through. And he's a smaller, undersized guy that you could tell he's going to be in position to make plays often, but he's probably not going to be able to at a high enough rate for them to avoid having some issues there. Chad Adams seemed like he played reasonably well. Daz Tautalatasi, he was where they needed to be. I think from an assignment soundness standpoint, they probably only had a few breakdowns that resulted in big plays, explosive plays, and they weren't really behind the defense unaccounted for. So those are other sort of things that they can use as building blocks moving forward. The communication on the field after the initial play had been called was actually reasonably good. They may be asking a little bit too much of their linebackers from a range standpoint. Christian Sam, DJ Calhoun, they're just having to get to places on the field with runs that are really, really difficult.
And Todd Graham mentioned in the post-game press conference that he said this might be the game with the least busted coverages that he's seen since he's been at ASU. Now, Kevin, if you're San Diego State and you're looking at film of this Arizona State defense after one game, what are some things that you're pointing out?
There was a lot underneath. They probably get a lot of more short games. New Mexico State might not have known what they were going to get tonight just because it was a different look than we'd seen the last few years. So there was a lot more sitting back, cover three, stuff like that. So they're probably going to probably try to work the middle of the field a little more because that's probably a little open, and maybe try to expose the linebackers in space. I didn't think Christian Sam played terribly well, but he wasn't, you know, just didn't make an impact tonight. I thought DJ Calhoun was good, but I think you made a good point. If those guys are out there all night running around like that and got to cover in space, they're going to get exposed at times.
Yeah. Chris, and now for ASU going into San Diego State, what are some things that you or at least they would like to see from themselves?
Well, they need to just take that first to second game step that coaches will tell you usually. You get some film of yourself, you see what you do well, what areas you struggle, you figure out how to mitigate some of those things that you don't do as well. You continue to use those teaching points to get some of your younger guys developed who can maybe come out and fill in and help you. Rennell Wren was live-legged when he came into the game. He was ready to do it. Shannon Foreman, you talk about him all camp. Well, you got to be able to play him out there and throw him into the game. I think they got to get more of that. I think realizing what they have in John Humphrey and figuring out how to take advantage of him is an important step. J.J. Wilson is an athletic piece that I think you got to make sure that you utilize, and you got to address your protections and your blocking at the point of attack because you're going to need to have a more diverse game. And they really do need to take a big step forward. I know a lot of ASU fans after this game are saying, okay, this is going to be a long season, but a lot can happen over the next 2 weeks that make you have a little bit of a changed perspective about a team. So there's not enough to really put that in a Sharpie yet that ASU is going to be a bad team just because it beat New Mexico by, you know, a touchdown or whatever it ended up being.
Now, Kevin, something fun to finish off with, your player of the game.
John Humphrey. I thought he had the 7 catches, went over 100 yards, had the 60-yard touchdown. He made the biggest impact plays of the game.
Chris?
I'm going to say Manny Wilkins. It seems weird, but he completed 10 out of 10 in the third quarter when they needed that. Didn't have any turnovers. Were there any balls that were really jeopardy throws? I don't think so. So if you're going to throw the ball that many times, he didn't put the ball on the ground other than when I think Eno Benjamin hit him that one time when they came together in the
was that might have been Barnett.
No, there was a time before that. Yeah, time before that. So you know, I think in a broad sense, he kind of did what they were asking him to do, even though he had some physical mistakes, which are probably going to happen.
And what was something you were expecting to see tonight that maybe we didn't get to see from the Sun Devils?
I would say it was the defensive line rotation. We heard about it. We thought we'd see Rennell Wren. We thought we'd see Foreman more than we did. And I think that when you're going to send four guys more than you have in the past, I think you got to keep them fresh. And it's 105 degrees out or whatever it was after kickoff. Give Rennell Wren a couple snaps in the first quarter, give him a couple in the second, work him in there. He can play well against the run. He can play against the pass. You don't need to situational sub him. You just got to rotate him in, I think.
And Chris, something that surprised you to finish us off?
Same thing. That's like the most shocking thing that we've seen in a really long time. How do you play 11 players for 60 some odd snaps in a row defensively? No nickel, no defensive line rotation in the first game of the season against New Mexico State at 101 degrees of kickoff. That's like, we might be here for 30 more years and not see that once in a season opener. That's far and away the most telling thing. And there's a cumulative toll of that. It's not just one game. It's what happens over the course of a season when you're throwing your guys out there that much and when other guys aren't ready because they haven't been given those reps at earlier points in time.
There you have it, the theme of the night. Lack of substitution is a depth question. I guess we'll have to wait and see until the Sun Devils take on San Diego State here at Sun Devil Stadium next week at 8 p.m. For SunDevilSource.com, Zane Hopin, Chris Cartman, Kevin Stewart, thanks for watching.